morning, judges. My name is Mark Ting, and I'm a representative of the PACE Senior Robofest team for 2015. This year, we chose to build a 4-degree of freedom Stewart platform. So a Stewart platform is basically two hexagonal platforms that is identified by the groups of servos that are placed around it on the hexagon. A Stewart platform was developed the basic idea for a Stewart platform was developed in the 1950s, and the basic concept was simply that it would be able to interact on a 3D plane because of the way that the motors are configured. Now, obviously, technology at the time limited the actual applications of the Stewart platform. So what we chose to do is we chose to take this design and apply a mechatronic system to it to give it more consumer-friendly and more modern applications. Most conventional Stewart platforms right now are made out of linear actuators, which are pictured here. The main applications for these are things like flight simulators, NASCAR simulators, and things like that. So the fact that the platform can interact on all axes makes it very good for simulating airplane motions. What the Stewart platform is demonstrating right now is it's currently demonstrating its ability to move within the Z and the Y axes. So it's moving up and down, and it can show you different speeds. And what this is meant to do is it's to give some hint as to the versatility of the platform. What I'm also able to demonstrate is I'm able to demonstrate the platform's ability to follow light, which we take right now as one of its future applications. So if you can imagine, the platform itself, it has a solar cell on it. Obviously, we want to optimize the amount of light that the solar cell receives, so we would have the platform able to tilt towards the light. So whichever light sensor receives the most light will be the one that the platform automatically begins to tilt towards. Another demonstration that we've prepared for this platform is what people are most commonly looking towards using this platform for. So I'm about to demonstrate the platform's ability to auto-level. So if I tilt the platform, it will automatically do a motion to compensate for my tilt in order to try and keep this top platform here level. So to do this, I'm using an MPU 6050 3-axis gyro. So if you can see here, it's giving the values for the displacement and the yaw, pitch, and roll. And in order to prevent calibration issues, instead of having it deal with anything that's not zero, I instead have had the servos only act upon values when it changed. So I'm going to put down the microphone for a second, and I'll show you. So this is the pair of servos 1, which the gyro is directly across from. If I lift it this way, the platform automatically tilts against me to try and keep the top platform level. By the same token, if I lift it this way, to try and compensate against me. This was one of the more difficult parts of the platform to code, of course. And to do this, generally now, what people look towards are using inverse kinematics. So basically, people try and track where the top platform is based off of where the readings it's getting. Because this is a very complicated math, and I wanted to try and keep this platform simple so it's more accessible, what I did instead was I worked on a different way of doing it. So this is the algorithm that is shown here. The basic logic behind this is that the platform itself, because of the configuration, can only move a certain number of degrees. And I generated a multiplication factor, which was calculated by trigonometry, which would equate the maximum amount the servo could read to the maximum amount that the gyro could produce. So we saw the two future applications for that, the auto leveling and the light following.
Hello, my name is Taeyeon Lim, and this is my partner Jun Young Ho, and we're Team Buzz. This is our robot Baywatch Boybot, and the problem that we're having is the rip current that are forming in the beaches. And this is a picture of a few years back when a rip current happened and a lot of people got injured because of this accident. And this is a little diagram of how a rip current forms and how a rip current happens. And according to Cadwell's research that we read on an article, it was about the ability of beachgoers, and we realized that the ability of the beachgoers, they tend to their surrounding. They don't recognize their surrounding of their danger. So we decided to make this. That's the cause why we made the robot. And this is a boy bot diagram that we actually drew, and it's a side view of our robot. So now to the description for our robot. So there are three main ways the robot identifies danger: the laser, the camera here, and the underwater camera. The underwater camera, what it does is it recognizes the sharks and jellyfish attacks, and when it does recognize, as you can see, this is live right now. And when it does recognize the lifeguards on the center watching this, will set off an alarm with the robot and saying that there's a shark attack or jellyfish attack. We need to evacuate the people. And there's three main ways the robot alarms the people. One way is by the siren, one way is by the LED. And the siren starts beeping, and the LED light starts to blink. And it tells the people like they're in danger, you need to evacuate. And one important way, another way, is by this water beacon that we made. So what it does is it shoots off a water into the air, but however, now right now it's covered because it's in the inside. And we made this because to warn the people more faster and better. And we calculated this by saying, like, let's say like a person is standing at a shore and the robot itself is placed 100 meters away, and then the water jet is shooting up the water into 30 meters high. We calculated that it is 17 degrees by using tangent. We calculated that it was 17 degrees minimum height, the minimum angle that the person can see. And in any distance, the person can see the water shoot up. And we use the LED light to shine the water, so even in the night they can still see the water shoot off into the air. And another part that I forgot is the camera and the LED the laser works together. So the camera and the laser works together, and it's a live stream right now, so it's kind of, the camera is delayed. As you can see, the camera works in the daytime and the laser works in the nighttime. The camera works in the daytime is because it's clearly visible, but in the nighttime the camera cannot identify if it's an object. And that's where the laser comes in to help. And the laser, as you can see, is demonstrating right now. The laser is creating a red line because it's spinning. And the person there is, like, a human has a 3D feature. And the 3D feature that the human is showing, the camera recognizes it. And the whole thing goes off an alarm. So the reason why we have this three sand, the metal ball, and the metal ball on the other side is because to balance out the robot, when there's the ocean, there's a lot of tides. So when the tides hit, the robot will flip over if there's no balancing function. So we decided to put the metal balls, sand, and the metal other balls on the other side to balance it out. However, right now it's 90 degrees, but when you're actually making the real robot, because it's a prototype, when we're making the actual robot, we decided to make this into 120 degrees is because like the circle is 360 degrees, but when we actually divide it into three by exactly, it's 120 degrees each, so we're moving this into 100 degree angle. And the way that the robot moves is by the laser, by the water jet on each side and the one at the back. And it positions itself towards the people. And we believe that the beachgoers have to be well prepared for their own safety. The robot in action will help the people nearby. Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Kiara Berger, and I was in charge of poster design and research. Our project is to test and improve people's ambidexterity and their hand-eye coordination. Ambidexterity is the ability to use your right hand and left hand equally well.
I'm Paul Olivier, and I was in charge. sort of mechanical design of a robot. Now, the first thing we did is we constructed a frame on which the robot can drive. For the robot itself, we split it into two parts to make programming and construction easier. The first part is a Lego brain module, which we constructed out of Lego because it's lightweight and very modular. It's got the two Lego servo motors to drive the robot on the y-axis and one to lift the lifter arm on the z-axis. The touch sensors is used to reset the robot, and NXT is the brain of the robot. The base is the second part of the robot, and we use high-tech DC motors because it's got a lot more torque than the Lego motors. We also created our own custom wheels to keep the motor from driving off the track, and to communicate with the PC where the joystick is housed, we used NXTB, which is a radio communication device which uses serial comms to communicate.
Hi there, my name is Dean Winnie, and this year I was in charge of programming the robot. The program that runs on the robot can be divided into five parts. The first two parts are tasks and the last two are functions. We use tasks and the last are multitasking so that multiple tasks can run at the same time. The first task is the task main. This is where the program starts. It starts off by initializing the high-speed port 4 where the NXTB is plugged into. It also starts the other two tasks. The next task is the receive data task, which reads the script. Serial data received by the NXTB, and then assigns those values to global variables. The next task is the motor control task, which takes the values from the previous task and assigns them to the appropriate motors to allow for the control on the X and Y and the Z axis. The Z axis is controlled by a function because it's using buttons, so we don't have values to control the power. So when you push up, it allows to go up and down. And we've also using the end remote control to limit how high it can go.